Quins and fours and fives, which is quite appropriate, as I have four guests, or, you know, five if I include myself. On the one hand, here's Aisling B. No two ways about it, it's David Mitchell. Three cheers for Nish Kumar. And at sixes and sevens, Alan Davis. What are their buzzers for? Aisling goes...
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
David goes...
5, 5, 5.
Oh. I was ready to get into that.
I think that was someone singing five.
OK, got it. Nish goes...
5 bad boys with a power to rock you.
Yes. And Alan goes...
4.
Question one is about quadrupeds. Name a quadruped that can't swim.
My mum?
Is she often on all fours?
No, no, now, Alan. Oh. Alan Davies.
Alan Davies.
If we could come away from any thoughts about Nish's mother being on all fours, I would appreciate it. So, quadrupeds...
Now, Sandy, I feel like this relies on everybody knowing what that word means.
So, quad...
Four.
And ped...
L-O.
Feet. You had it, so quad...
Four feet.
Four feet, you totally knew it.
And your mother has 4 feet.
I am 4 feet.
Can you swim? Is that the answer?
So, we're more in the animal world, people. Mm. We're not in the Kumar household at all.
OK.
They all float, don't they?
Well, when they're dead.
Yes.
Yeah, they float to the surface eventually when all the stomach juices start to decompose, yeah. They'll bob up then. But is that really swimming?
It's good to have you back, David. Cheerful Mitchell.
They float because of the air in their lungs. It's only when their lungs fill with water they won't float. So but, unless you can't keep your breathing passages above the water...
You're right. What might not be able
to do that? An elephant.
Well...
Of all the animals, probably the most likely to be able to...
Inbuilt snorkel. Yeah.
Is it a blue whale? It's... Sometimes it is.
It could so easily have been a blue whale had it had any feet at all. So the elephant is rather brilliantly evolved, in fact, to be able to swim, because it possibly that was a snorkel, the trunk.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
You know.
That's yeah. Someone got excited in the pool.
So elephants can...
Giraffe.
Giraffe is exactly the right answer that we're looking for. As we know, nobody has ever seen a giraffe swim. But there were two academics called Darren Nish and Don Henderson, and they decided, by careful computer modelling, to test out whether a giraffe can swim. And they concluded that giraffes would float but not swim. And actually, if they did swim, they'd be particularly bad at it. So, look at this.
Aww.
So here's the problem, is that giraffes have these really heavy, bony heads. So if all four legs of a giraffe were to leave the bottom of the river, the giraffe's hips would float higher than the shoulders and they would float downwards. So now what's going to happen with the head?
Yeah.
It's going to go under the water. So it's got to crick its neck back like this. So a giraffe to be able to swim would have to be in this position. So the conclusion by the scientists is giraffes would be very poor swimmers and that it might be assumed they would avoid this activity if at all possible.
Could it not do a backstroke?
I think that's worse, probably. So now you're having to be like this.
Ooh. Oh, wow.
You like the look of that, Nish?
Goodness me. Listen, if you've got a long neck, use it. It looks like me when I was a teenager.
The other creatures that have difficulty swimming are apes. How do they know apes have difficulty swimming?
Planet of the Apes films.
is one way. You never see them swimming.
Never see them swimming, Planet of the Apes.
Scientists were not sure if apes could swim, so they just dropped them in water. There was a guy called William Hornaday. He was the founder of Bronx Zoo. And he had an orangutan pet, which he called Old Man. And he just dropped it in some water. And he said, I watched him sink and go stiff. And there was an American animal behaviourist called Robert Yerkes. He similarly submerged young chimpanzees to see what happened. And he says, without exception, they struggled excitedly and quickly sank.
Oh, my God. That's
awful. That's why you have moats around the enclosure with the apes, because they don't want to swim. What about camels? Anybody?
What are the humps going to do? Are they going to be buoyant? Probably.
Do you think camels are the descendants of giraffes who learned to swim because their lungs went up their back and their head started to go like this? They bring me on here for the big thoughts.
I really want the next series of Blue Planet to be presented by you. Yeah. Maybe giraffes are just camels.
Yeah. Hmm. It's very like David Attenborough was in the room. Some camels can. There's an Indian breed called Karai. It's known as the swimming camel of Gujarat. Hippos?
Definitely
swim.
They're
great at it, aren't they?
Well, they more bounce than swim. Imagine that this is now a hippo. They go like this along the bottom of the river. And they can stay underwater for about 5 minutes.
They kill a lot of people, don't they, hippos?
Yeah.
Hippos are hungry.
No! Yeah, I'm going to give you the giraffe as a prize. I think that's...
I went to a zoo once in India and,
and
they had two white tigers. Very spectacular sight. And they had a moat around them and then a fence. And we thought, well, thank goodness there's a moat.
Yeah.
Because they're savage. And then they both got in and swam across the moat. Right up to the fence.
What?
Everyone
Why?
Absolutely shat them.
We don't think of cats as being swimmers, but all domestic cats can swim.
Yeah.
They just mostly can't be bothered.
Well, they don't like it.
No, they don't like it.
My cats hated it in the bath.
Why'd you put them in the bath?
Well, they fell in.
You like one of those animal behaviourists,
don't you? No, I didn't drop them in. I used to lie in the bath for hours. And it was against the wall, so the side of the bath on my right was very, very slim ledge. Really for a seabird or something, but I didn't know. One of the cats could go along that ledge and did a little paw work, and the other cat just couldn't do that. But one day decided he was going to give it a go. And I was saying to him, don't, you can't do that. Just get back. Get back around there. And he said, I'm doing it. I'm going to do it. And he went like that, and then he just fell straight in. To get out, he clawed up my legs and then across the wall. So then there was just blood and fur in the bath. And I got out to see if he was all right, and all of his fur had gone down, and he's just a tiny skeleton with wet fur on and massive eyes. I put him in a towel and put him on top of a radiator.
I absolutely love the idea that you talk to your cats like that and they reply in your voice, you don't want to do that, I'll give it a go.
Babies, do babies have an innate ability to swim? What do we reckon?
No.
What's the audience think?
No.
Yes!
No, they drown.
Can I just say, do not do this, it is not true.
But a lot of people say it, though, don't they? A lot of people say,
just chuck them in.
Drown! Because we're all evolved from fishes, and when you're a baby, you still sort of think you're a fish, and so it's all fine.
I think this Nirvana album had a lot of responsibility for this idea. It's not true. Babies do naturally hold their breath, but do not put them in the water. They do not have an innate ability. Giraffes would find swimming a pain in the neck, but... are elephants any good at drawing?
Yeah, there was that elephant who could paint.
Yes.
Is that him?
That's the one. Yeah, yeah, he's shy.
Yeah. Well, actually, that is an elephant with a paintbrush stuck up its nose.
There's an art gallery in Thailand that features a permanent display of paintings by elephants, but this is actually about another sense of drawing.
Is it pulling along?
It is pulling along, exactly right. It's pulling along a chariot. A Roman general's triumph involved his riding in a quadriga. So a quadriga, anybody know what a quadriga is?
Four-wheeled chariot, one elephant.
OK, so it's four creatures pulling a quadriga. So usually it was four horses and they would pull them through a triumphal gate, an archway of some kind. So Pompey the Great's first triumph, 79 BC, he thought, totally going to overshadow everybody. I'm going to have four elephants to pull my quadriga to reflect the fact that his victory was in Africa. He got to a gate. What was the problem?
Too wide.
Yeah, couldn't get through. He had the embarrassment of having to get down while they swapped the elephants over for horses.
They have one of those things, you know, when they say no lorries over a certain...
But the quadriga is an amazing... It was kind of the Formula One car, if you like, of its day. Do you remember the film Ben-Hur?
Oh, four in a line like that.
Yeah, four in a line. It's a wonderful film. It's 1959, has some of the most outstanding anachronisms in movie history. There are modern books, despite the fact that binding was about 1,000 years away. There's a shot of the Sistine Chapel ceiling about 1,500 years before it was painted.
Also, I'd like a lot of films of that era, Jesus was a white guy.
Yeah.
As opposed to someone who looks like me.
Yeah. Nike, the winged goddess of victory, is normally depicted riding a quadriga.
Her famous phrase was, just do it.
Yeah. Why was it important for women, the quadriga?
To have four horses.
It's a really interesting part of sporting history. What do we know about the early Olympics and women?
There weren't any.
There weren't any. Women were not allowed, except in the capacity of horse owners or trainers. The very first female Olympic winner was a Spartan princess called Cenisca, and she won the quadriga races in 396 and 392 BC. Women were not allowed to participate. They weren't even allowed to watch. But as a trainer, she was the winner. She's the very first female Olympian.
Wow.
But she probably never saw the race.
My mother is a retired jockey. That's not a joke.
True.
Yeah. I grew up in a really horsey town where everyone was a jockey or a stable hand.
And could have got together with Nish's mother who goes around on
all fours. Oh, my God.
She is going to be... this is one of the few programmes I do she watches anyway. She's going to be absolutely livid.
Is your mother tiny?
She's older than you. she always says that when she won, they'd say the horse was very fast. And if she lost, they'd say, well, you shouldn't put women on horses in the first place.
Wow. Anybody think of statues of quadriga that we see on modern-day monuments anywhere around the world?
One down near Westminster Bridge with Boudicca on it.
I don't think it's a quadriga. I think it's just two horses, that one. The Wellington Arch at Hyde Park Corner. So there we are. Wellington Arch, the Arc de Triomphe and the Brandenburg Gate all have quadriga on top of them. Where might you see the only one which survives from antiquity?
I'm going to take a shot in the dark here. Rome.
Venice, St. Mark's Basilica. Not the one that you see outside, it's actually inside, but that is the only one.
There's a thing of it when Venice basically attacked Constantinople. It was supposed to be a crusade to go and attack the Holy Land, but in fact the crusade attacked Constantinople instead and took a lot of Constantinople's goodies back to Venice.
Yeah.
And I think a couple of things were from the big chariot racing Circus Maximus place.
Well, quadriga racing was such a huge deal in Roman times. So Circus Maximus, 150,000 spectators. So, Alan, how big is Wembley?
90,000.
Yeah, so 90,000. Wow. You can imagine, you think how big Wembley is and you think of those people who went along to the quadriga racing. You have to understand
but
the
it's
passion.
Quite long, the Circus Maximus, isn't it? It's longer than this.
Is it?
I reckon it's two football pitches long, maybe more.
Right, but I love the detail. Circus Maximus was bigger than that. It was bigger than that. Closest thing to a chariot race these days? There is one famous race that takes place... actually, it's twice a year.
The wheelbarrow. All right, but we're not going past my mother's.
It's in Siena. It is the Palio horse race in Siena. It is
they go through the town.
Unbelievably exciting. It's around the central square of this historic city. And it's very like quadriga racing because it is de rigueur for the riders to hinder each other, to bribe the opponents pretty much as they please. The whips, they're made of dried, distended bull's penises.
Oh.
And they use them not just on the horses but on each other. And the winner is the first horse over the line, whether or not the jockey has come with him.
See, I always think that would be an interesting take on the Grand National, because quite often a horse, unhampered by a human being, actually wins. And you sort of think, in many ways, we're holding them back, aren't we? Let them run.
All of them look like jockeys, except the guy in the blue in the middle, who looks like he's the victim of a drunken prank. he was on a stag do, and then he's just woken up and gone, shit, I'm on a horse!
And there's no saddles, so they're going bareback.
Yeah.
It's a bit like the Amish in that they limit the technology they're allowed. They're not allowed the whips, they've got to be bulls' penises, they can't be. I mean.
They've got to dick slap each other.
Also, who makes those whips? Do you know what I mean?
The cows.
Yeah. The cow. I'm just imagining some old Italian man whittling away at like a big knob until he gets his down.
Well, I do this for a long time, long time. It's my only job. Once a year, I'm important in the town. I make a little dick whips. It's an honest day's leaving.
That was my Italian accent. Yes, Mr.
You're like the sort of the rogue fifth member of the Dolmio family.
Do you think the length of the whips is dependent on the weather?
It depends on how many sexy cows have won.
I dispute the fact that these bulls' penises would still display arousal after they've been severed and dried. I'm pretty sure mine wouldn't.
We'll never know, David. No. Or perhaps we will.
Mine's barely functioning and it's still attached.
OK, let's move on. We're a lot tamer here. The only people who race around a square in this country are students on foot. You know, like that scene in Chariots of Fire where they race around the square in the middle of the college, you know.
What's it called?
Come on, audience.
Mara.
Quad. OK.
I can't believe you fell for that.
Yeah.
Bad luck, audience. You guys suck.
It's a curiosity about Cambridge. All quadrangles are called courts, apart from the court of Downing College, which is a quad. And the race depicted, that one in Chariots of Fire, it takes place annually around... Anybody know which court is it?
Cambridge College.
It's quad.
The event they're depicting takes place at Trinity College, but they filmed it at Eton.
They did film it at Eton, and a quadrangle at Eton is not called a quad either, it's called a yard.
And these are the people who will one day be in charge of the government. Interesting.
So the real-life race is against the clock. It's a 370-metre course, and they have to get round in the time it takes the clock to strike 12. Depending on when it was last wound, it could be 43, it could be 44 seconds. There used to be a similar tradition that MPs and House of Commons staff would attempt to run across Westminster Bridge at noon during the time it took Big Ben to strike 12. So that's 353 metres. They have to do it in less than 46 seconds. The very first person to do it was a Commons tea room worker called Florence Eilot. Mm. On April the 14th, 1934, she was aged 20. There she is.
Oh, wow.
I love this picture because Big Ben has still got scaffolding. The speed required is... It's only about 17 miles per hour, as opposed to modern championship sprint speed, which is about 28 miles per hour. But she completed the feat with time to spare. She actually made it by the 10th chime. And I'm delighted to tell you that her son and grandson are with us in the audience.
Oh, wow. Great!
Wow! So, Scott, it was astonishing because her 400-metre time, it wasn't far off the world record at the time, is that right?
Well, apparently, yeah, we don't really know quite where she started and where she finished, but she was pretty bloody fast by the looks of it.
Mm. And did she just carry on working at the House of Commons, or what happened to her?
She was an amateur runner, that's what she did in her spare time, and she met her future husband, my granddad, his dad, while running. But it was amateur days, of course, so they didn't make any money out of it. They'd win prizes, canteens of cutlery and things like that.
Well, that would be fine on this show, wouldn't it, if you went home with a canteen of cutlery?
Very, very pleased.
This is nothing to do with anything, but you and I have worked together, have we not?
Yes, I was a question setter on 15 to 1.
You set about 2,000 questions for me, you bastard. OK.
Yes,
Greg and Scott back. Now, what happened when the quadrupunctate Gribble went to the seaside?
Is quadrupunctate Gribble one of the more obscure Harry Potter characters?
It certainly sounds like it belongs in an Edward Lear poem, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Doctor Zeus book. Now, come on, quadrupunctate. So, just break it down.
Punctate would be a work of art done by a punk.
Yes. So it's not four punks.
Four punks. Essentially, it's just sprayed.
No. But I love your thinking. So, it is a wood-boring creature. And a basically, it's horrible. And basically, when it went to the seaside, it ate Yarmouth Pier. It has four holes or punctures in its thorax. It is apparently well known to coleopterists. What are coleopterists?
People who study absolutely disgusting shit.
Some people like to call them beetle specialists. There is also a thing called a tripunctate, and they're easily confused with the quadripunctate because they sometimes have a rogue fourth hole, but they're not actually quadripunctates.
I'm sorry.
Oh, no. David, you never get it the other way around. You never get a quadripunctate with only three holes. No. I mean, this is extraordinary how much I know about this.
What's the one, the tripunctate?
A tripunctate
that occasionally has four holes.
It's a rogue fourth.
A rogue tripunctate.
It's kicking about. It's pretending to be a quadripunctate.
What is the difference?
One's got three and one's got four.
Yeah, no. What is the difference between a rogue tripunctate and a true quadripunctate? And why does anyone think it matters?
I don't really know. In 2007, this quadripunctate cost the Isle of Wight over £400,000 because, well, not just the one, there were lots of them, at Yarmouth Pier. It's sort of terrible.
And are they English?
Here he is, the voice of Brexit Britain.
The fact is, Alan, they were brought here on ships from other countries.
Oh, for God's sake.
I know. Let's have a look at some other quads and quins. What do you think this quintet of words mean? Pick anyone at random.
Well, a quinsy, if a onesie is a one outfit, a quinsy must be five outfits on at once.
Five pieces of clothing. You can choose any five pieces randomly and you've got yourself a quinsy.
I would have two gloves, two socks and a little hat on my knob.
It's David's quinsy! So it's kind of temporary accommodation, if I'm completely frank with you.
A tent?
It's a sort of igloo, but what you do is you make it by simply hollowing snow out. An actual igloo is an almost astonishing architectural feat because it's the only domed building in the world which is built without a structure to support it during its construction. Mm. But sometimes you don't need long-term accommodation, you just need to protect yourself. And what you do is you hollow out snow, and that is called a quinsy. The word is actually an indigenous word from northwestern Canada and Alaska, but that is a quinsy. Let's go back to our list. Nish, want to pick one out, Danny?
Quincunx.
It's to do with die or dice.
A five-sided dice.
So it's the layout of the five on the dice, one in each corner and one in the middle. Often used, actually, as a pattern for planting trees in an orchard, quincunx.
Looks like it's a shape modelled on my quinsy.
Yes, it does, doesn't it? Yes.
I'm not saying the scale is the same, just the general pattern.
Yeah. Yeah. What's upsetting is every time I play with dice now, that is what I'm getting. Yeah.
Smiling up
on Mitchell's penis.
You've got a four and I've got a David Mitchell. Yeah. So that is a quincunx. Let's go back to our list.
Quidnunc.
Quidnunc, what do you reckon?
Quid, money, nunc, nun. Bankruptcy. I am quidnunc, sadly.
Quidnunc. Well, it is a word that was used, particularly in the 18th century. It describes an unnecessarily inquisitive person. It's Latin for what now?
Ah.
But it's really a gossip, a quidnunc. But it's good expression, isn't it? What have we got left? Alan?
Quinitor is a five-legged dinosaur.
It is five-horned. Five-horned.
Five-horned.
It is exactly right. It is a five-horned bull.
Right. Yeah!
Deleted scene from The Shape of Water.
This five-horned aquatic monster was supposed to be the father of Merovich, who was the founder of the Frankish Merovingian dynasty. Only mentioned once in all of history.
He is punching above his waist there, I feel.
There was a guy called Fredegar who wrote a history of the Franks in the 7th century AD, but otherwise this particular character is entirely lost to history, so it seems to have been this guy's entire fantasy.
I love how sort of like, what now, the fisher?
Yeah. That's fish all over, isn't it, though?
Yeah.
Have you ever seen a fish really look impressed?
Never have, David. Never have.
I've never seen a fish point something out in wonder.
No. Yeah. They're so fucking blasé.
Okay, well, and that's your cue vocabulary, suitably quintupled, but which do you fancy, being quartered with your grandparents or impaled with your other half? What do you reckon?
Is it a family tree question?
Sort of. Why do you say that?
Well, because you've got four grandparents.
It's to do with heraldry, is the truth of it. Heraldic convention. So
you
could,
if you're going to create your own symbol, yeah, you do it in combination with your other half or with your family.
Exactly that. You're on fire today.
Whoa!
Very good, yeah, very good.
I thought it was going to be something to do with torture. Like, would you like to be quartered with your grandparents? Like, yeah, a form of old torture. Like Game of Thronesies or something like that. Game of Thronesies.
Game of Thronesies.
Game of Thronesies.
That's the one I watch.
You can't pay attention because you've literally got a giraffe between your legs.
Just love learning. Oh, turn me on.
Oh my God.
It's nice to watch something happen and go, that's going to be a gif.
So it's a heraldic convention quartering whereby arms inherited from different ancestral lines are combined into a single coat of arms.
It is the one, like in the royal coat of arms, it's divided into quarters.
Well, it implies that it's divided into four. Yeah. But there's no theoretical limit to the number of quarters that you can display. If you have enough what's called armigerous forebears, it is possible to have all of the elements of your family put into one shield. So in the 18th century, the Marquis of Buckingham, he achieved 719 quarters on a single shield. I mean, it looks like a mosaic, doesn't it? It's absolutely
looks like a magic eye picture.
So the four thing that you're talking about, darling, when it's split into four quadrants, they are called quarters, and the arms they contained are called quarterings, but a shield can have as many quarterings as...
You can quarter it and quarter it and quarter it.
As you are entitled to. Yeah. So impalement, which was the other one, is when a married couple's coat of arms are displayed side by side on a single shield. And by convention, the husband's side is the dexter side. Anybody know which side that is? Dexter?
The right.
It is the right, but it is...
From the point of view of the knight?
It's exactly, right, my darling, okay. Yes. Extra point to you. It is entirely on the point of view of the person who is actually holding it. Does anybody know what the one on the right might be? Why might you have one that looks like that?
When you got a couple of wives.
Exactly right.
Is that right?
Yes. Usually one's dead. I'm not saying...
Oh, right, right, right.
Two at the same time. First wife goes on top.
Always.
Always. Always.
Calls the shots.
In the bedroom and the grave.
Yeah.
So did Henry VIII have one with sort of
stripes?
Wives?
Just stripes.
On it, yeah.
Stripes all the way through. Yeah.
A couple of heads hanging off it.
The College of Arms have now updated it and they have same-sex married couples' shields as well. It's all a very modern
world. Did it all come from having to show what team in the army you were from? Again, that's probably terminology you're not au fait with, but it's definitely real and right.
OK, well, I have the very person who can answer this question for us. We have in the audience the Clarence King of Arms, Patrick Dickinson. Patrick, thank you so very much for coming in. Why did it start? Why do we have these?
Oh, actually, it's absolutely right. It's because if knights were in armour and you couldn't see who they were, the shield told you.
Right. And how many are you, the kings of arms?
Three in England, one in Scotland.
Right.
Four altogether.
Now, there are people who say this is an extraordinary waste of public funds. Do you mind me asking how much you get paid to be the Clarence King of Arms?
And we're not supporting public funds at all.
Fantastic.
We get salaries from the Crown,
right,
which were last increased in 1620. I'm paid £20.25 by the Queen, and that is the level to which it was reduced by William the IV in the 1830s.
You haven't had a pay rise since?
No, not since.
What's like your daily, like, do you get up, have your coffee, check your emails, put on your arms? Like, what's your daily?
Then do I put on all that kit?
Yeah.
No, I set about designing coats of arms, tracing family trees, that sort of thing.
What's the weirdest thing you've had as a request to put on a coat of arms?
Go on.
Is it by any chance from a D. Mitchell and it's a penis with a hat on it?
It's a urinal on a... but a urinal in the sense of a doctor's flask.
Oh, fantastic.
And footballs have appeared. I put one in Elton John's coat of arms.
That's fantastic.
Yep.
It is a real honour to have had the Clarence King of Arms here.
Yeah.
Now, Now, since we're talking about quads and quins, here's a question on multiple births. What's the best way to avoid paying income tax in Hungary? Bob!
Don't work in Hungary.
I think that's fair. Yeah. Mm.
It is, in general, the most fail-safe way of avoiding income tax. Yes, mm-hmm. Avoid income.
Yeah. Look at that building, isn't it stunning? It's the Parliament in Budapest. But the quickest way at present to achieve income tax exemption is to have quadruplets.
What?
I know. So, February 2019, the Prime Minister, Viktor Orban, announced that women who have four or more children will be permanently exempted from income tax. Why might he decide to do this?
I feel like there's probably a not particularly fun answer to this, that it's about getting more and more Hungarians.
It's about
they don't want immigrants.
They don't want immigrants,
and they're trying to repopulate with real Hungarians. Isn't that a thing?
It's essentially encouraging breeding as an act of racism.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. I don't think if I moved to Hungary and managed to produce four kids...
He'd be thrilled.
He wouldn't be delighted.
No. You don't have to have them all at the same time, which is good, because having quads was like winning the lottery. In humans, the odds against having twins in a natural birth are 89 to 1. For triplets, it's 7,921 to 1, so 89 squared. For quads, it's 704,969 to 1, so it's 89 cubed.
Doesn't the likelihood go up through IVF and stuff like that?
Yeah, this is a sort of rule of thumb. It's called Helen's Law. It is just to do with natural childbirth and natural conception. Mm.
So, looking at that, the best route would be just not to declare all of your income.
Can I just say that having quadruplets, so much easier for the boy. Have a look at this picture. She's had four children, and he's having a cigar.
That's Stephen Fry.
So, while we're on this subject, what was the Toronto Stork Derby?
Is it a race with storks delivering babies?
Yes, yes. So, this was a multi-birth contest in Ontario. In 1936, it was described by the province's premier, Mitchell Hepburn, as the most revolting and disgusting exhibition ever put on in a civilised country. What happened was there was a great guy, I think, called Charles Miller. He was a lawyer, he was a financier, mm-hmm. he was a practical joker, and he had nobody to leave his money to. And so he stated in his will that whoever could have the most babies in 10 years could have his money.
Grim.
Yeah, it attracted a huge amount of interest because some of his investments made a lot of money. It was a huge fortune. His $100,000 estate turned into a $750,000 fortune by the end of the race, and mothers went crazy.
You could only have 10 max, though, surely, or like 10 and one on the way.
No, if you have multiples, if you have twins.
You could have sextuplets 10 times. You could have 60.
Oh, right.
So that woman, who looks frankly exhausted, was one of the contestants. She had 13 children. Five women had 56 babies between them. We don't know how many of those were multiple births. And in the end, the pot was eventually split four ways with two consolation prizes for women who had been disqualified.
Women who've been disqualified?
What did they get disqualified for?
Maybe they'd adopted.
Borrowed that would babies. Be,
I've adopted 700.
Some of the babies were illegitimate and so disqualified.
What?
Yeah, that's harsh.
He was a great prankster, Charles Miller. He left brewery shares to a prohibitionist campaigning group on condition that they actually ran the business. Racecourse shares to anti-gambling clerics. And he left a holiday home in Jamaica to three men who hated each other on condition they all lived in it together indefinitely. Sounds like a great sitcom, doesn't it? The Toronto Stork Derby, the most disgusting exhibition ever. Mm. Well, until now. It's time for general ignorance. What's your normal temperature?
Isn't it lower if you're a woman than a man?
Slightly higher for a woman.
Slightly higher.
Yeah, it was one or the other, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. Just go either way with that, actually.
Because, you know, there's that stereotype of, like, turn up the heating, but I'm too hot, babes!
It is an issue that office temperatures are set to male averages as opposed to female averages.
Do you know a fact about Christine Lagarde, who's the head...
I don't know any facts about Christine Lagarde.
Oh, well, you're about to bloody get one, Sandy. Let's swap chairs! Knock your glasses for a second.
Okay. Do you want some cards?
Yeah.
Oh, no, that's got all the answers on there. Have that.
Of course, the interesting about Christine Lagarde that she used to do was that she... Please stop laughing, darling. I'm trying to get to the fact. She, when she'd go into business meetings, would put on a lot of layers for the meeting and turn down the heating so it'd be freezing cold and they'd all be shivering so they'd make a deal quicker.
Is that true?
Yes, or sometimes she'd turn up the heating really hot and she'd come in like a small dress and the men would get really sweaty and then they'd try and hurry through the meeting.
I love that about her. That's
Thank you very much.
Fantastic.
That's a little bit arrogant.
Normal body temperature, but, you know.
97.6. That's not what I said.
Oh, no.
It has often been said 98.6 is a sort of normal temperature.
I got it wrong, of course.
97.6 is most recently dead.
It turns out there's no single value for normal. There was a study in 1868 by a German doctor with the wonderful name of Karl Reinhold August Wunderlich. Oh. He had a thermometer that was a foot long. Put it under people's armpits and it took 20...
Oh, thank God.
I know. It took 20 minutes to actually assess what the temperature was. And it turns out the thermometer, which has been recently retested, had been calibrated wrong. And it ran about 3 degrees higher in Fahrenheit than a modern thermometer. Mm. And the fact that he took it under the arm, which produces readings that are lower and less reliable than temperatures taken orally. So he was working with errors in both directions, basically. It's no wonder he settled entirely on the wrong answer.
So there he is. There is a picture of an idiot.
Well, actually, you were inadvertently, possibly, closest. The average actually comes out at about 97.7. And you said 97.6. So I think you should get another point for that.
That's very good.
He's even getting them right by accident.
Yeah. So you've each got a way of measuring temperature beside you there. So let's see which one we think is the most reliable. Nish, what have you got, darling?
I've got a sort of piece of paper.
Yeah, do you know how those work?
Up the butt.
Well, good luck with that. they're all happy to wait.
Does it go on the...
Put it on the forehead. Now, why might that not be ideal?
Oh, because heat rises to the top, so your head's the hottest part of you.
No.
You know what? I genuinely thought you were going to go, yes, and everyone's going to go, ooh, and it just didn't happen at all.
So here's the thing, it's measuring the temperature of your skin and not your body.
Oh.
So similarly, if you put it on your scrotum, that would be wrong. The reason men have a scrotum is it's deliberately to keep the balls a bit cooler than the rest of the body.
Yes.
I did not know that.
A better way would be to design testicles in a way that it can be at the same temperature as the rest of the body, but it was in some way fudged. No, it's fine, I'll just have them in a disgusting flesh bag. That's workable for a few hundreds of thousands of years.
I love that we've agreed on disgusting flesh bag.
Yeah. Actually, you know, the Isle of Wight is only 7,000 years old.
Are you saying it... Are you saying it's like the scrotum of England? Below, kept slightly cooler by all the water.
I wouldn't like to say that to the people on the island. No.
Alan, come back. Ashley, what have you got, darling?
I have one of these little lads.
Yeah, where would you put that?
Ear?
No. It would go under your tongue.
Why do it go under the tongue and not over the tongue?
Underneath the tongue is full of blood vessels. It's almost as accurate as your rectal area.
Listen, sometimes it pays to get here early.
David, what have you got?
It's the first time I've heard a rectal area described as accurate. I've got this.
It's your ear.
I've accidentally turned it on. It's currently it says 35.5, which seems very high for the air.
It's hot in here.
I
thought it was just my age.
Shall I pop it in?
Yes,
go on, see what your temperature is.
You can hear the sea, apparently, as well.
Yours, my darling, is actually a garden thermometer, but, we couldn't get rectal thermometers because they don't really allow them anymore. Why might that be?
Too fun.
No, bloody dangerous.
You forget you put it in, then you sit down and it reappears out of your mouth.
Shards of glass when they break, mercury. Oh. Unbelievable. What is your temperature, darling?
It says 36.1, which, considering it's 35.5 in the room, I think... be pretty cool.
Now, here's the easiest question ever. What city are we looking at here?
Westminster.
Yes.
Oh,
oh yeah, that's very good. That's very good.
Highlighted things, the city of Westminster. There's also another city in London. What is the other city in London?
London.
It is the city of London, so the...
Yes!
Yes. Wow, it's good to be that excited. we have the city of London, which is the financial district, but Greater London is actually a ceremonial county rather than a city, and so the conurbation which we call London, it contains two cities. It is not itself officially a city. What is the difference, however, between a city and a town?
Well, it used to be that cities had cathedrals. there's somebody, obviously, in the gallery can't hear the phrase, it used to be.
The city has a multiplex and a Nando's.
It's a purely honorific thing. It's granted by the sovereign by letters patent, and it has nothing to do with whether you have a cathedral. There are now 18 cities without a cathedral. There are 16 towns that have cathedrals but are not cities. And lastly, here's a quadrilateral. Is this shape A square, a rectangle and an oblong, or B, a square and a rectangle but not an oblong, or C, an oblong and a square but not a rectangle, or D, a triangle?
Who's whispering in the audience?
B.
She sounds like she knows.
Yeah, you like that? Yeah. Goes with your surname, you want to go with it?
Yeah. Ashling, B, please.
B, please, is absolutely right. Well done to the audience.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
A rectangle is defined as a quadrilateral with four right angles, and a square complies with that definition, so a square is a rectangle. I mean, it's a special kind of rectangle. It has four sides of the same length. But an oblong is defined as a rectangle which is specifically not a square. So the square in our picture is a square and a rectangle, but not an oblong. Well, I think, strictly speaking, that point ought to go to the audience.
Yeah.
Which brings me to the quinquaddly business of the scores. Let's see what kind of shape they are in. In first place, the winner, fair and square, with minus four, is David. In second place, with minus five, Alan. In third place, with minus seven, Ashley.
Yay!
In fourth place, with minus eight, the audience. Last place, I'm afraid. It's back to square one with minus 18. Nish! that exhausts the possibilities of quads and quins for tonight, so it's thanks to Ashling, Nish, David and Alan. And I leave you with this quote about quads. In 1851, Charles Calverley was showing some visitors around Balliol College, Oxford. This is Balliol College, he announced, as he led them through the front quad. This is the master's lodgings, he continued, waving at the building. He then bent down, picked a stone from the path and hurled it through a nearby window. And that, he said, pointing to the man screaming at them through the shattered glass, is the master himself. Good night.